Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome. COVID-19 has been a defining moment for all the world, and the aftermath, repercussions, outcomes are really still being played out as we speak. There have been many opinions, perspectives, and debate as to the best way to manage and also emerge from the pandemic. But one thing I believe is absolutely clear, and I think the whole world is agreed on, and that is the fact that the COVID-19 pandemic has accelerated our move to online, to the digital age. As we emerge from the COVID-19 pandemic, which has accelerated our move to digital, Africa stands at the cusp of an opportunity to leverage and enable inclusive growth using technology that is already available to us. But we need to be deliberate and intentional about how we're going to go about this. We have many things working to our advantage. Africa has probably the youngest population in the world. Our youth represent our present and also our future. How should we be harnessing the power of this demography to catapult Africa to its future? We have a section of our population that is also yet to be fully harnessed and fully engaged, women. How do we ensure that women in Africa are not left behind in this journey to digital transformation? With me to discuss how Africa can use the opportunity of the COVID-19 pandemic crisis to shift to an inclusive, impactful and digital economy are two women who are very well versed in this matter and have also incidentally worked together, working out or architecting Africa's response to the COVID-19 pandemic. Rita Roy, President and CEO of the MasterCard Foundation, and Vera Songwe, Undersecretary General of the United Nations and also the Executive Secretary of the Economic Commission on Africa. Vera, welcome. Rita, welcome. Vera, I'd like to start with you. You know, I know that you're very committed to the transformation and diversification of African economies. Can you also tell us how UNICA is working to ensure technology plays a more central role in this transformation and diversification?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mobola. It's nice to see you again. It's been a long time. And you yourself, I must say, are part of those who are helping to change the world with technology. So thank you as well for all the efforts that you're putting in and for supporting us. And to you, Richard, good to be on the platform with you. So since the crisis started, I think in some sense, as Hillary Clinton will say, we should not waste a crisis. I think one of the things that definitely Africa has done well during this crisis is really deepen, you know, access to technology and the use of technology. We've seen quite a number of countries use technology for different things. How has the Economic Commission for Africa helped? We've done three things that I think I must say I'm quite proud of. We've done many others, but I'll talk about the three that are the most interesting. The first was our launch of the African Communications Informations Platform. We call it ACIP, in collaboration with four major networks. And one of the reasons I'm quite excited about this initiative was that for the first time, we brought together the four major mobile network operators across the continent and had them share one sort of smart code number, which is the 4 or 5 digit number that you text on your phone to send and receive information. And essentially, we were trying to gather information, enough information and data for governments to be able to sort of decide, you know, when the pandemic was hitting a particular region, what they needed to do. And in sort of, you know, in time analysis of, you know, where, of course, we're an Economic Commission for Africa, we started looking at prices, inflation, which today we see is becoming the topic across the world. And we were wanting to sort of be able to send questions back and forth to citizens. We have now on this platform over, I think, 2 million people that have connected to the platform and are actively using it. In Congo, for example, the platform received over 35,000 responses on perceptions of the sort of USS of COVID-19, what is happening, and including the head of state could use it and send messages back and forth to his citizens. So I think this one is something that we're very interested in, very excited about. We have 7 more countries. We've launched it in Congo. We're now about to launch it in 7 other countries. And I think this is really going to be able to give us on-time, ready data that we can use for other things. The second thing that we did, which is thanks to Rita and the MasterCard Foundation, we're going to be able to build on, is the Africans Medical Supplies Platform, which was launched by the African Union in partnership with Afriexim Bank under the leadership of President Ramaphosa, but also the special envoy, Strive Masiwiya, that has been working with us and, of course, working very jointly with Africa CDC. The African Medical Supplies Platform is really, you know, when COVID hit, there was, you know, a dearth of PPPs or PPEs, and nobody could find, you know, mask or even sort of oxygen mask. We couldn't find face masks. We couldn't find syringes. We couldn't find anything. There was a scarcity of it. And even in the developed world, countries were sort of struggling to see who will get to the supplies faster. So what we decided to do on the continent was say, what if we procured everything that the continent needed in terms of, the PPEs, and then try to buy it at one point of sale. And what that did was, if you think back to that time in March of 2020 through June of 2020, I don't think you will hear anything about Africa not being able to find PPEs. But that was really because we came together, did the sport procurement, launched a platform where everybody could come on that platform and procure. And we were working at the back of that platform to ensure that we had suppliers. But the thing I'm the most excited about on this platform is that we also had a space for African producers. So we could actually say, yes, you could come in and buy PPEs from every part of the world. But if you wanted to buy PPEs from African producers across the world, and we had just launched the AFCFTA, you could actually do that. Today, we have 252 buyers that are actively engaged in this platform. The AMSP pipeline has orders representing about $2.1 billion. And we have about 65.9 million worth of merchandise that has been processed. This is a new institution that the continent has created. It essentially is a trading platform for health supplies, for COVID-related supplies. And I think it gave us a sense of, you know, what Africa can do when Africa comes together and buys collectively and in bulk. Because if you think of smaller countries, they cannot readily access a lot of the equipment that they needed. And finally, the last sort of technology-based platform that we are about to launch is what we're calling the African Trade Exchange. Again, around the AFCFTA, we've said that the AFCFTA is what is going to take Africa out of this crisis. To do that, we have to be able to come together and create a platform that allows us to trade collectively. But on top of the ATEX is also what Afriexim Bank has just done, which is it created a currency exchange platform. So prior to its launch of its platform, it's called the Mansa platform. If you had to trade between Benin and, say, Kenya, you had to change CFAs into dollars and then dollars back into Kenyan shillings. Now, and each time, of course, there was a commission, so you lost resources. Africa lost resources in that process. But with this Mansa platform, you just go from shillings to CFA and backwards. And so that also saves quite an amount of resources. If you're a small and medium enterprise woman business, every $10, every $100 that you save is what sends your kids to school. So again, a huge, I think, investment that we're able to make with substantial and visible gains in terms of technology, but in terms of improving prosperity on the continent. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Vera. That's a tremendous amount of work in such little time. And I must say that the one that resonates with me the most is really around collecting data, because I know in my time as a minister, one of the biggest challenges we had was having enough data to be able to make policies, formulate policies that would actually address, you know, particular issues or be relevant to a particular context. So fantastic work. Rita, let me turn to you now. You know, we're talking about the centrality of technology, you know. So when, I'm not going to say if, you know, because Vera has told us all the things that UNECO is doing to really make technology central to the transformation of Africa. You know, when technology is begins to play a more central role, then it stands to reason that really and truly there should be more tech-centered jobs. There'll be more tech-centered jobs created on the continent. How do we ensure that young people in Africa are aware of those jobs and are properly equipped to take advantage of these, to take on these jobs?
Thank you so much for the question. But first, let me begin by saying what an honor it is to be on the same platform with both of you and to thank you for your leadership in closing so many inequities across this continent. The question is so germane because in your preface, you talked about how youthful this continent is. In fact, it gets younger every single day. And clearly, with the advent of COVID, some of the examples which Vera mentioned are just starting to accelerate. And what's clear to us is that young people are coming of age in digital technology. And already we are seeing so many young entrepreneurs who are building businesses in multiple sectors, whether it's in manufacturing, agriculture, health, the creative sector, which have a technological backbone or digital backbone. But clearly there are also quite a few gaps. And at the foundation, we try to think in, you know, two major pillars when it comes to young people and skills. First, it's really about digital literacy, and the other is about digital platforms. So with literacy, quite clearly digital literacy, just as basic literacy in the old days as we knew it, was a passport into the economy. And there's so much more we have to do, particularly in the area of secondary education. Last year, we released a report on the state of secondary education across Africa. And this is a major transition point for the majority of young people into the economy. So more has to be done at this point, at this juncture, to equip young people with skills before they even enter the economy. So we're doing a number of things. For example, in Rwanda, which is where I'm based, we have a major initiative known as Leaders in Teaching. We also have a Center for Innovation in Teaching and Learning, which is zeroing in on how we equip young people, young educational entrepreneurs, to equip young people with skills. We're doing a lot more in higher education and working with universities across the continent. One, for example, like Carnegie Mellon University, also based here in Rwanda, but really working across the continent to begin programs, master's levels programs in engineering and artificial technology. And it's not just teaching, educating, training young people, but their whole educational experience, how they acquire those skills, also needs to be in part digital, and to combine in person, when we all get back to being in person, but in person and virtual, so that they learn by experiencing. And probably most importantly, when we look at our work around Young Africa Works, which is a major initiative of the foundation, with a very aspirational, bold goal to create 30 million work opportunities, dignified work opportunities by the end of this decade, we know that we need to equip young entrepreneurs with the right skills, with access to finance, and to ensure that level of integration as we look at the economy.
Thanks so much, Rita. You know, 30 million is a massive, audacious goal, but I'm just so confident that we can get to that with the foundation support. And at this point, I really must thank the foundation for your support of the newly established University of Technology and Management in Nigeria. We're running courses on technology, entrepreneurship, and design, and we're seeing, you know, tremendous, the amazing entrepreneurship mindset of young Africans is really just incredible. So I'm fairly sure we can get to that. And you know, as you know, I'm a partner in a venture capital firm now, and we are seeing, you know, a lot of innovation, billions of dollars coming into the continent to support these tech-enabled companies that are solving many of our grand challenges. So this panel was themed putting technology to work for the common good. And you know, that implies, and to a certain extent, Rita, you started talking about that already. So that implies inclusion in all its ramifications. And you know, as you both work across the continent, you know, what do you see is the link between innovation in Africa and inclusive growth?
Well, you know, the first thing which pops into my mind is about the nexus there is about scale and being able to go much further, more inclusive, and reach millions and millions more. But clearly, it's this powerhouse, this combination, which brings together, expands e-commerce, it expands opportunities for smallholder farmers, it creates new ways of us thinking about how we deliver education and the quality of that education. This is about enabling small businesses to prosper, small businesses to continue to grow. And when I think about all of this, I want to also put a caveat in here. Technology is amazing. But the very problems which we are trying to solve require us to step back and look with intention, that the design of our work is actually removing barriers that women face, that young people face. And then we ask the question, how can technology scale these interventions?
Absolutely. Scale, it's a huge continent, so scale is just absolutely important. Vera, how about you? What are the ways are you seeing that technology can help us to really drive this inclusion agenda?
I think three things, and of course, everything that Rita has said is very right. It's all about scale. Before we get to scale, there's also, you know, technical capacity building and getting a sense of, you know, what people can do. And one of the things that the Economic Commission for Africa has done is we launched, I think also as part of a desire to maybe just give hope to everybody in a time when it was just so difficult. We launched the sort of UNECA Girls Can Code initiative. And it's just been amazing the amount of interest that we have seen from young kids from Zimbabwe to Zambia to Cameroon to Ethiopia itself. But also, I think what it has permitted us to do is create almost an African platform. So we now have girls in Kenya, young girls in Kenya, designing, you know, health and e-health platforms together. Girls in Mauritania, young girls in Mauritania, and young girls in Cameroon designing e-platforms together. And I think that those kinds of collaborative efforts, because a lot of technology and a lot of the huge breakthroughs we've seen in digital and the digital space have happened out of collaborative efforts. And I think what we're managing to do is get this women together. So far, we've trained about 30,000 young women on sort of different Girls Can Code platforms, depending on the interest. And we hope to do more. And I think this is one of the things we need to start doing is creating virtual Silicon Valleys, right? We in Cameroon, we talk about, you know, Silicon Mountain. In Kenya, we talk about, you know, different Silicon space. And we want to bring those spaces together virtually and have us see what we can do together. And I think that has been just amazing, amazing. Now, of course, we're financing some of them to see how we can actually, it's one thing to sort of teach them how to sort of do robotics and, you know, the internet design and really actually messaging. And I think one of the things that has come out of that is we didn't realize it, but many of these women started, you know, doing Netflix games after taking our courses. They're doing TikToks on, you know, respect for women, you know, a lot about sort of, you know, respecting the women in the societies or, you know, illnesses. And they're now discussing, you know, rural issues in a platform that they would have never had the opportunity to use before. So I think it's really spreading knowledge as well. And that for me has been just an amazing feat to see these girls come in at the beginning. Some of them have never seen a computer before, are curious. And in 3 weeks, they can actually design something and we can take it forward.
I just love the fact that you're doing this with young girls and young women. It's just, it's amazing how quickly they learn. Because I also experienced when we had this digital program for women in Nigeria, for young girls in schools in Nigeria, they learn so quickly and they adapt very, very quickly.
Exactly.
Unfortunately, we've run out of time. I mean, we could be discussing this for the next hour or two. And I really just have to thank, you know, Vera and Rita for the insights that you brought to this conversation. But more importantly, the very concrete things you're doing to help us move to the digital economy along with the rest of the world. I know that this conversation will not stop here. There's a lot of work to be done. And, you know, many thanks to the Economic Commission Africa and also the MasterCard Foundation for just putting time, talent and real big resources behind this this big challenge that we're all working through. So thank you all very much. And thank you for participating in the panel.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your leadership.
Thank you for having us. Thank you.